Hello student, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Ajeet Jaiswal from Department of Anthropology, Pondicherry University, Puducherry. Today we are going to discuss about module entitled Homo habilis under paper Biological and Physical Anthropology. Student, in this module we will try to find out the answer to this question like who is Homo? What was the climatic condition when first Homo appeared? Where did the first Homo appear? And how do they look like? The stone tool industry of the earliest Homo and the food habit of the earliest Homo. Let me give you a complete introductory information in order to find who is all about Homo. Many scholars give different view about the origin of human. Like Charles Darwin, he said that Africa must be the birthplace for modern human, because anatomically living human are similar to African apes. Similarly, Ernst Haeckel, he said that Asia must be the birthplace for human, because according to Ernst Haeckel, Asian great apes, orangutan, is more similar to human than the African apes. A common limitation here is that both the scholar, that is Charles Darwin and Ernst Haeckel, they use comparative anatomy and they did not analyze any fossil. Later on, Dubois agreed with Ernst Haeckel and started looking for more fossil in Asia. In 1891, he found a partial skull from a bank of Solo River, which lies near a village called Java. Trini in Java, having a cranial capacity of about 1000 cc. So, it is neither a human nor ape, because the cranial capacity indicate that they are much more evolved, much more developed, much more better than the apes. Similarly, this cranial capacity itself also shows that they are not as evolved as it used to be of that of human being, because their cranial capacity is somewhat more than 1350. He gave the name Pithecanthropus erectus, or upright walking ape man, later came to be known as Homo erectus. However, now question arises over here. Was Dubois fossil from Java belong to the earliest species of Homo? No. Dubois and Haeckel, Ernst Haeckel, were wrong in thinking that earliest human would be found in Asia. Then, when, who were the first member of the genus Homo? This question arises. When this one is not the first one, then who were the first member of the genus Homo? When did they appear and where? How they adapted to the environment? These are some of the important questions that we will try to discuss in this module. But this was not the earliest one, this is true. The earliest Homo was discovered only after 7 decades from Africa, not from Asia. Let's define Homo. It will be very easy for us to recognize a Homo sapiens in living form, but will you be able to recognize an earliest Homo if you ever found? What type of characteristic feature you will be looking for in order to call it Homo? So let's define the genus Homo before going further. We all belong to the genus Homo. Genus Homo is characterized by having enlarged brain case compared to Australopithecus group. Further, the member of this group had a less projecting and flat face with reduced teeth and jaw size. Their body size was large and they were perfectly biped, meaning striding bipedalism. These characteristics found among the member of these groups may be related to various adaptive strategies, including a shift to a more animal-based diet, dependence on manufacturing and use of stone tool and technology for gathering and processing of food instead of depending on their body. In other words, they depend more on cultural practices as adoptive strategy. With this culture, they increasingly controlled and influenced the environment and started exploring new habitat. However, earlier members of Homo are less different from the Australopithecines as compared to later members, making it difficult to distinguish between them. Hence, the first Homo is not much different from some of the Australopithecus at all. Pleistocene climatic condition. Shifting from Australopithecus to Homo implies some set of adaptive strategy which was compelled by the changing climatic condition. So we need to have some idea about the climatic condition during the time when the first Homo appeared. The first species of Homo appeared around 2.5 million years ago, says in the late Pliocene and early Pleistocene. This period coincided with the greatest climatic variability. Ice sheet became permanent feature at North and South Pole during the early Pliocene. Cyclic glaciation began about 3 million years ago and become increasingly intense throughout the Pleistocene. The glaciation became so severe that it lowered the sea level enough to connect Iceland of Southeast Asia to mainland Asia for the first time. This phenomena is important because Homo started to move out of Africa. This severity in climate may also be the reason for enlargement in brain size and increased intelligence among Homo. Adapting to such hazardous environment may have honed human intelligence. Fossil record of Homo habilis, the earliest Homo. Ever since the accidental discovery of Tong child from South Africa in 1924, a number of Australopithecus fossils were excavated from East, West and South Africa. In 1960, almost 7 decades after Dubois discovered Homo erectus from Java, Lewis and Mary Leakey discovered an extraordinary partial skull from Old Bazar in Tanzania, the same site from where Robustus Australopithecus, also known as Paranthropus, was discovered. The skull belongs to a juvenile and it is dated to about 2 million years ago. It is derived from the Australopithecus by having relatively smaller face and larger cranial capacity. The estimated average cranial capacity of earlier Homo skull is 631 cc compared to 520 cc for all the miserable Paranthropus specimen and 442 cc for Australopithecus. Recognizing the significance of these characteristics, Lewis Leakey, Philip Tobias and John Napier gave a new genus Homo and named it as a Homo habilis, meaning handy man or skilled man, referred to the use and manufacturer of stone tool. In addition to fossil, bone and teeth, some stone tools were also discovered from Old Bazards. Initially, it was thought to be remains of Australopithecus, but later they were convinced that the discovered material were of Homo habilis, who really manufactured and used it. Thus, most anthropologists agreed to Homo habilis might be the first maker of stone tool, and this marked the beginning of a lineage leading to modern human. Initially, reorganization of Homo habilis was met with skepticism. However, with additional finding from other part of Africa, it confirmed the presence of such early member of the genus. Now, Homo habilis is found from heather and Homa in Ethiopia, Urcha in Malawi, Cimarron Formation and Kobe Fura in Kenya, besides Old West George in Tanzania. See the picture of fragmented frontal view of skull of Homo habilis. The fossil dated about 1.9 million years ago. It was discovered from Old West George. The fragmented part of the skull and teeth gave us a lot of information about the habilian characteristics. It reflects a partial skull of juvenile dated about 2 million years ago. The cranial capacity larger than any of the Australopithecus specimen, have relatively smaller face and named it as a Homo habilis or handyman. It is also known by a code 0H7 or Old Y hominid 7. About a decade after Homo habilis was discovered in the early 1970s, Richard Leakey and his team discovered a more intact skull of Homo habilis from Kobe Fura, eastern shore of Lake Turkana. The skull was dated approximately 1.9 million years ago and known by the National Museum of Kenya. This fossil greatly differs from the one discovered from Old West George, having a large cranial capacity of 775 cc. The difference between the largest specimen of Homo habilis or early Homo and the smallest specimen is too large to be grouped together under one single species. The cranial capacity of the largest specimen is almost one-third larger than the smallest specimen. Moreover, the smaller specimen have longer upper limb compared to the larger specimen, which is a primitive feature. Hence, many scholars prefer to call the larger specimen with a new specimen named Homo rudolfensis. However, the two type of specimen have similar brain to body proportion. The specimen with larger brain size has a larger body and the one with small brain size has smaller body. So many scholars claim that it was male and female individual of the same species. Since both the fossil have same general body plan and overall morphology, we can consider them as a single species. Homo habilis are early Homo, but not to have confusion between Homo habilis and Homo rudolfensis. We will use the term early Homo to mean both. See the picture of a fragmented frontal view of skull of Homo rudolfensis fossil. The fossil was discovered from Kobe Fura, eastern shore of Lake Turkana, Kenya. Dated about 1.9 million years. It has a larger cranial capacity than 0H7 species. Scholars prefer to call it as a Homo rudolfensis, but based on overall morphology and similar general feature plan, we can consider both as one species. More fossil. Now Homo habilis is found from Hadir and Oma in Ethiopia, Urcha in Malawi, Cimarron Formation and Kobe Fura in Kenya, and Old West George in Tanzania. Or East Africa have yielded a wide variety of fossil remains, predominantly Australopithecus, along with early Homo and Homo erectus. Early Homo roamed in East Africa from about 2 to 1.4 million years ago. The latest Australopithecus was seen in East Africa in about 1.5 million years ago, and the earliest Homo erectus appeared in East Africa in about 1.8 to 1.9 million years ago. By putting all this evidence together, it can be reasonably presumed that at least one species of early Homo was evolved in East Africa about 2 million years ago, along with an Australopithecus species, coexisting contemporarily for at least 1 million years, after which Australopithecus apparently disappeared forever. One lineage of this early Homo might evolve into Homo erectus about 1.8 million years ago, and all other species of early Homo become extinct sometime about 1.4 million years ago. Now let's discuss about the important feature of Homo habilis, especially physical feature. The physical features of Homo habilis are as follows. The skull of early Homo, they became more rounded with extension of brain case. Forehead become slightly visible. The face is less projecting and reduced in size, with smaller and arched eyebrow ridges or brow ridges compared to Australopithecus or earlier ancestors. The foramen magnum, the hole for the attachment of the vertebral column, was located in the center of the skull base, indicating bipedalism. The average cranial capacity is estimated to be about 630 cc. The jaw of early Homo, they become smaller with more rounded dental arcade than those of Australopithecus. The teeth become smaller, but the incisors were still relatively large. The size of the body is relatively small, and the leg and foot bones indicate that they were definitely bipedal. Homo habilis culture or stone tool culture. The earliest stone tools were discovered from Old Wise George in 1959. When the Australopithecus bossai was excavated, and it is estimated to be about 2.5 million year old, the same site also yielded another hominid, that is Homo habilis. At first, it was thought that Australopithecus bossai manufactured and used these tools, but later on it was realized that Australopithecus bossai will be too primitive to have made something so sophisticated. Therefore, these tools were used and manufactured by Homo habilis. Whoever have manufactured and used it. The earliest stone tools are available from 2.5 million years ago. These tools from Olduvai are so named as Olduvan tool industry, taking the name of the site from where it was found. These tools from Olduvai George are so named as Olduvan tool industry, taking the name of the site from where it was first found. Most of the tools were core, water smooth cobbles 3 to 4 inches across, modified by knocking off a few chips from one or two faces to make a sharp edge and a flake, a small fragment recovered from the core. Other tools found from Old One Industries were hammer stone. It was used to break open the bones of large animals to get marrow, and also to manufacture flake from the core. Authorities initially thought that the Old One tools were all core tools, and that flakes were the waste product of their manufacture. However, experiments have suggested that majority of the core were the raw material for the manufacture of flake tool, which were used as cutting and scraping tools. Cores were used to produce flake multiple times until it becomes too small to produce flakes, and where sometimes flake can be very sharp and are effectively used to cut through tough animal hides, to remove meat from bones, or dig out roots and tubers. Early Homo seems to have traveled some distance in search of superior raw material to produce sharp and durable flakes. They may also probably carry those cores with them in order to remove flake whenever required. So, if early Homo carried their tools around, it must be because those tools were an important part of their daily life, like cell phone and wallet in present-day life. Analyzing the pattern of tool use at various sites in East Africa, archaeologists categorized these sites into different types. In some sites, stone tools are used in association with varieties of mammal bone, some of which bear cut and percussion marks made by stone tool. So such site may be the butchering sites. Stone tools are also found in large number in some particular sites where the raw materials are found to be abundant, but not in association with bones. These sites may be quarrying sites from where they get raw material for manufacturing stone tool. Similarly, Isaac proposed a third type of sites called home base, some more comfortable central place, perhaps near a set tree or a water hole, where early Homo repeats brought butchered carcasses. They manufactured or refined and stored tools in these sites. They slept and ate in greater safety in these sites than the place where animal was killed. But this hypothesis faced skepticism due to lack of proper evidences. However, experiments have suggested that majority of the core were the raw material for the manufacturing of flake tool, which were used as cutting and scraping tools. Cores were used to produce flakes multiple times until it became too small to produce flake and were discarded. See the picture that explains the technique of removing flake from core. As these tools from Old War George are so named as Old One Tool Industry, modified by knocking off a few chips from one or two face to make it a sharp edge, and the small pieces of these tools are called as flake, small fragment removed from the core. Other tools found from Old One Industries are look like a hammer stone. It used to break open the bones of a large animal to get the material from the bones. So this particular feature explains the stone hammer technique, where with the help of one piece they are trying to convert the core, or giving a proper shape to the core tools. And the pieces that removed from the core tools were called as a flake, that may sometime in future will also be used as a specific tools. Food habit. With the availability of sharp stone tool, animal foods became an important adaptive strategy for early Homo. The first indisputable evidence of tool use for getting animal meat is from the cut mark on the fossilized bone of antelope about 2.5 million years ago. However, despite the enormous amount of evidence of meat eating in the form of butchered bones, we do not know how often early Homo might have eaten meat, or how important meat was in their diet. How they get those meat? Do they hunt or scavenge? There are three probable models on how they acquire carcasses. First model say that active hunting where group of early Homo might courageously attack and slaughtered large and dangerous game. Second model is confrontational scavenging. Large and dangerous game may be hunted down by a large predator such as saber-toothed cats. Early Homo may bravely fight off this predator to gain access to significant amount of meat. Last model is passive scavenging. Early Homo may patiently wait till the large predator who hunted down the big game left and carcasses after finished eating to get a few scraps of meat and fat. So, it is important to know whether early Homo evolved as hunter or scavengers, as this activity indicates a different set of behavioral adaptation. Analyzing some of the cut marks on the fossilized carcasses, it is evident that carnivores first chewed and butchered late. Bone from Olduvai sites show cut marks by the gnawing of contemporaries, lion, hyena, etc. And on the top of that, early Homo's cut marks were found. This inferred that early Homo eat flesh from the bone after it had already been chewed by predator. So at least occasionally, early Homo scavengers not hunt. There are more evidence of scavenging by early Homo. Analyzing the animal bones found from early Homo site, the climatic condition may give the most unfavorable condition for survival to early Homo, but they are successful to survive through it with adaptive strategy. This adaptive strategy include enlarged brain, manufacture and use of stone tool and technology. This led them to explore new and nutritious animal-based diet. The success of early Homo set the stage for the rest of the hominin evolution. So, the first early Homo appearance appears in around 2 million years ago. Before they disappeared, a new hominin species, Homo erectus, appeared, equipped with more enhanced adaptive strategy, which soon spread all over the world out of Africa. Okay, let's try to recap some of the important points related to Homo habilis that we have discussed in the earlier section. Genus Homo is characterized by having enlarged brain case compared to Australopithecus group. Further, the member of this group has a less projecting flat nose, flat face with reduced teeth and jaw size. Their body size was large and they were perfectly biped, meaning they striding bipedalism. Shifting from Australopithecus to Homo implies some of the adaptive strategy which was compelled by the changing climatic condition. The first species of Homo, which appeared around 2.5 million years ago, belongs to late Pliocene and early Pleistocene period. Remember the geological time scale, Pliocene and Pleistocene period. Earlier members of Homo are less dominant from the Australopithecus as compared to the later member. That make it difficult to distinguish between them. Louis Leakey, Philip Tobias and John Napier, they gave a new genus, Homo, and name it as a Homo habilis. The meaning of Homo habilis means handyman or skilled man. The handyman or skilled man referring to the use and manufacturing of stone tools. So, the Homo habilis is also called as a stone tool man, handyman, skilled man. Homo habilis was found from Ethiopia, Malawi and Kenya besides Olduvai Gorge in Tanzania. Thank you.